Good evening, everyone. Good evening. Welcome to our prayer time, our grow class, time of worship together. And I'm going to keep on saying it till we get past it, but Merry Christmas to you. We're a little early still. How many of you have completed your Christmas list? All right. I don't mean the one you wrote up for yourself. I mean the one someone gave to you. Just me saying that probably put some stress on you, and that was kind of intentional. I'm actually speaking about that a little later on. Hopefully I can be an encouragement to you from the Word of God. But great to be together. Exciting time of year. Just remembering the birth of Christ, the reason he came, which was to go to the cross in our place, to rise again and provide for our salvation. So that's the good news we've got to tell the world. And hopefully you'll have opportunity this Christmas season to do that. Looking at our prayer bulletin this evening, a few things on this week and looking ahead. We have our Thursday men's prayer time in the morning. I encourage you to come out to that if you're available. This coming Sunday, we will have normal services Sunday morning, which means we'll have Bible fellowships and our morning worship service as usual. And then in the evening on Sunday, we'll have our Christmas Eve candlelight service, 6 p.m., and I hope you'll be able to make it out for that. We were just talking moments ago about the snow the last two Christmas Eves. 2 years ago, a lot of snow. Last year, not too much. And it looks like snow came early this year, so we've got clear sailing ahead for Christmas Eve. You can see the church office closings there. And then next Wednesday, all ministries will be canceled here at the church. So just a heads up on that. The youth are going away right before New Year's, so be in prayer for them for an enriching time as they're away at that Strength to Stand conference. A couple of prayer requests that we have. I've got a number to add to the list, but I wanted to highlight a couple there. Sylvia Beckett has gone on to be with the Lord. And just ask you to pray for Whitey and the family and her home going there. And a wonderful lady, longtime member, involved in the ministry, teaching, and especially in music. You remember her playing the piano and organ here and playing so skillfully. So, but now her mind is clear and her strength is restored. She's with her Savior. She's good. But it's hard for her family left behind. Please lift up the family of Francis Fleming as well. Rosie, Pete, and Vivian's sister, please be in prayer for their family who are going through the same grieving during Christmas this year. And then I mentioned Gypsy Calvi and Richard. Richard is not doing well. I think Richard's very close, of course, in the Lord's timing, but to seeing Jesus, it's that serious. So pray for Gypsy. That's hard to stand by and watch and experience. And just pray for her strength and comfort for her, the Lord's timing, and Richard going to be with Jesus. So lift her and the family up as well. And there's many other important needs there I encourage you to pray for tonight and this week. A few that were submitted here, Jack Witten, W-H-I-T-T-E-N, Jack Witten. This is Susanna Hannum's brother-in-law. He had knee replacement surgery yesterday and is recovering from that, so please be in prayer for his recovery and rehabilitation there. Kelly Bennett has submitted a number of requests. Kelsey Lowe, K-E-L-S-Y, Kelsey Lowe, is at UVA undergoing some testing. She's asked for our prayers, so please include her in your prayers. Richard Scott, who's kind of been on and off our list in weeks gone by, even months gone by, he is soon to begin his cancer treatment. He's trying to figure out the best type of treatment, so please pray for Richard Scott. Also, June Johnson. She has two spots and needs testing and MRI, so please be in prayer for June Johnson. And then one more, Jane Huffman. She's in the hospital, recently had surgery and still having some complications. Jane Huffman is her name. So if you'll add those to your list and keep those families in your prayers. Let's go ahead and stand together and worship our Lord in song tonight.
Grab a hymn book. Let's just sing through as we worship our Lord and Savior.
Oh, little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie above thy deep and dreamless sleep. The silent stars go by, yet in thy dark street shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. For Christ is born of Mary and gathered all above. While mortals sleep, the angels keep their watch o'er wandering love. Oh, morning stars together proclaim the holy birth, and praises sing to God our King, and peace to men on earth. O holy child of Bethlehem, descend on us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. Oh, come to us, abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel. It came upon the midnight clear, that glorious song of old, from angels bending near the earth to touch their harps of gold. Peace on the earth, goodwill to men, from hence our gracious King. The world in solemn stillness lay to hear the angels sing. For lo, the days are hasting on, by prophets seen of old, when with the ever-circling years shall come the time foretold, when peace shall over all the earth its ancient splendors fling. And the old world send back the song which now the angels sing. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching, o'er silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds feared and trembled, Christ is born. Down in a lowly manger, the humble Christ was born and brought us God's salvation. That blessed Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Amen. You may be seated as we go into a time of prayer.
Heavenly Father, we come to you this evening and we thank you so much, Lord, that we can remember that glorious time in history when our Savior came to earth. And Father, as they were instructed to go tell it on the mountain, and Lord, the shepherds definitely went out and told what they had seen, and Lord, the wonder was upon them. And Father, we have that same direction today, not to tell that he was born, but to tell that he died for us, Lord. He gave of himself for our sins, and we need to go tell it on the mountain and everywhere. Father, we ask you this day, Lord, to bless us as we come and share with one another that wondrous story, and we share the opportunity, Lord, to lift up brothers and sisters in Christ. And Father, we ask you to look after our teens as they go on a retreat, and we ask you, Lord, to give them a wonderful time and help them, Lord, to grow in grace and grow in Christ. And Father, we pray for the waits as they're working, Lord, in Slovakia, and Father, we ask you, Lord, to bless them as they had a recent joining by baptism to their church. And Father, also we ask you, Lord, to help them as they do their work in Ukraine, Lord, and reach out to that war-torn country. Father, also we ask you, Lord, in the name of Jesus, to remember these cancer patients, this long list on this sheet of paper, Lord, and Father, each one struggling with their own conditions and situation, and Father, some tolerating the medicines very well, and some, Lord, struggling with the medication they get. But we pray, Lord, that each of them have a remission and a full cure of the cancer in their bodies. Father, we also pray for this nation that we love and we were blessed to grow up in a time where people knew who God was, Lord, and even the man and woman who didn't go to church and worship the Lord, they respected the name of God and Jesus Christ. Today, Lord, we've shrunk away from that, and Father, we find ourselves going farther and farther away. We pray for the condition of our nation, Lord. We ask you, Lord, to bless us. Help each church reach out, Lord, and spread that gospel of Jesus Christ. And Father, we pray also for the wars that are tearing nations apart and pitting one nation against another. For the battle between Israel and Hamas, we ask, Lord, your compassion on those who are standing aside and can't help themselves, Lord, and caught up in battle. And Father, we just pray that your will be done in that situation. Father, also for the Ukraine and the misery that's going on there during a cold winter when people are struggling, Lord, just to keep warm. We ask you, Lord, also for your will to be done in that situation. And Father, for the Sudan that's been war-torn for years, Father, we ask you also to intercede there, Lord, and your will be done. And Father, we just ask that each of us continue to remember those nations as they struggle, Lord, with one another. And Lord, we just hope that you could intercede on behalf of the leaders of those nations, Lord, that you would turn their hearts toward the love of Jesus Christ. Father, for the men and women in the military that come from this church, we ask you, Lord, to give them opportunities, Lord, to take what they've learned from here and spread that gospel to their fellow soldiers and fellow men and women, Lord, who are serving you overseas and in this nation. And Father, we ask you to protect them and give them opportunity to come back home safely. Father, we remember our homebound and those who are not able to get out even on a good day to come and hear your word here in person. We ask you to bless them. Hope they can hear it online. And Father, we hope that we never forget them as they were a strong part of this church, Lord, and helped it to grow to the position that it's in today. Heavenly Father, we ask you, Lord, to bless Heidi Alphys, Father, as she's recovering from being struck by a vehicle. Also, Matthew Blauser also being hit by a car. And Lord, we heard recently that there was one hit just right down the road a little bit, Lord. And we just pray, Lord, that you help them to a full recovery. And Lord, that ever who was driving the car, well, Lord, to own up to the situation at hand, and if they're responsible, Lord, that they would ask forgiveness for that recklessness. And Father, we ask you, Lord, to bless Richard Calvi and Jesse as they deal with perhaps his last days for Richard. We ask you, Lord, just to comfort him, give him those assurances in his heart. And I know that he and Gypsy both have that assurance of where he will be when he leaves this earth. And Father, we just ask you to bless them both and bless those who are coming along your side to help them. And Father, for Aldo, we ask you, Lord, to help him as he's going through surgeries and having some tubes installed for home dialysis. And we hope, Lord, that he and Nancy can tolerate that and be helpful to one another. I hope their son can come alongside them there and give them a hand with that also. And Father, we don't want to forget Sylvia Beckett and her family. And Father, we just glorify you, Lord, that she's in your arms today, and their worries are off of her body and her mind, Lord. We ask you to bless her family, strengthen them, give them that assurance, Lord, of her well-being. And Lord, we ask that her funeral tomorrow, Lord, Friday, Lord, that there would be something said that would awaken someone who perhaps would not know you as Savior to come and surrender themselves to you, Lord. And Father, also for Francis Fleming family, we ask you, Lord, to be with them also, Lord. We hope that she was a child of God, Lord. We hope that her family, Lord, has that same assurance, Lord, of where she's at and who she's with. And Father, we glorify you this day in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Our dear Lord, we come to you, Lord, seeking, God, your mercy, God. We pray, God, for our country, God, that you turn it around and draw it back to you, God. Lord, in this time of year, when it is time that for the world to celebrate your birth, we pray, God, that the world would recognize that Christmas is a time of celebrating your coming to earth, leaving eternity for this sin-covered earth, God, and that all these activities and decorations and everything else mean little if we don't know the real meaning. We pray, God, for churches around the world to strongly preach the gospel message this Sunday, and for people to be in church on Christmas Eve, God, and hear the good news of the gospel, that there is hope, hope for this world, hope for individuals, but it only comes through you, God. You're the only one who's got the promise of life, God. And Lord, we just pray that you just do a mighty thing, God. Lord, we pray for all the many missionaries our church supports, God, as they're out there doing Christmas outreaches around the world, God, that you'll just bless those ministries. May they draw people to you, God, that'll be ready for when you return again. And we thank you so much, God, that you hear our prayers, God. Lord, I do pray not only for the two families here that are mentioned that are going through funeral services this week, God, but for the many others in our friends and families and church membership that have lost loved ones this year and going through Christmas this year for the first time without a loved one, and how in the world celebrating their insides, missing a loved one, God. May you give them your peace, God, as they go through this season. May they look beyond the loss and look with hope, God, if the loved one's in heaven, God, to look forward to that and have a hope and joy in their lives. And for the many here in our church and around the community that's traveling this Christmas, God, may you watch over and protect them on the roads. May this be a sweet time of fellowship with family. And God, for the other prayer requests we hear tonight, God, we pray, God, for Jack, God. We pray as he heals from this knee surgery, God, may it heal well. May he get his knee back working properly with minimal pain. And for Kelsey Lowe, God, I pray you give her your perfect peace as she's waiting on testing results, God, knowing, God, that everything is in your hands, God, and you're the master healer. And same with Richard Scott, God, as he considers cancer treatment options, God, may you give him your direction, God, what is best. And may you be with him, God. May he feel your tender mercy around him during these times. And same with June Johnson, as she deals with the diagnosis of spots and going for MRIs and not knowing perhaps what the diagnosis would be, God. May you be with her in a special way, and your peace, your care, and just be upon her, Lord. And for Jane Huffman, she's been in the hospital in and out for for more than a month now, God, and her health is not good. And we, God, we just pray you'll be with her and encourage her, God. And may she get her strength back up. May she be able to go back home to care of her daughter as she hopes. But Lord, it's all in your hands. We know, God, that you hear our prayers. Same with Tony Klein, God. We pray, God, that you will be with him as he. We thank you, God. He's doing better, but we pray for this ongoing stomach issues having, God, that you would just heal that condition and you'd be with him, God, in a real way. And for Joyce Hypes, God, we pray, God, for her well-being these holidays, God. We're thankful, know that she's now in remission. We pray that it will continue that way and that she'll have no further problems. And for Connie Reynolds, God, we pray, God, that you'd clear these shingles in her middle ear, God. May they not cause any lasting damage, God. And may the pain and all the problems with it go away, God. May you just heal her body. And for Debbie St. Clair, God, I pray, God, these blockages in her brain, God, that you'd clear those out in a miraculous way. May she feel your presence, Lord. And with all these prayer requests, Lord, we pray in you. And any unspoken requests here tonight, God, you know each of our hearts. And God, may you just bless the message that follows, God. May each one of us come here with open hearts to hear your word, God, willing to learn in whichever way you direct us, God. And we go out and shine your light this week as the Christmas day approaches. May we be willing to share with others the real meaning of Christmas. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for leading us in that time of prayer. And kind of another standalone message this evening. And I was really thinking through and praying through what to preach about this evening. And the Lord impressed on my heart the challenges that many are facing during the Christmas season. Yes, it's a bright and joyous time, but it can be a difficult time as well. A quick glance through the prayer bulletin this evening, and no shortage of challenges, right? We have Sylvia Beckett's home going and a grieving family there. We have the Fleming family as well. Gypsy, who I mentioned moments ago, Al Lowe, recovering from yet another surgery. Nancy trying to figure out how to administer dialysis at home. We could go on and on and on. That's just the tip of the iceberg. And then all the challenges and needs that are in the auditorium here this evening. So Lord, put this message on my heart. You see the title, The Present of Presents. If you had to guess where I was going, where would I be going? What name of Jesus? Any guesses? Emmanuel, God with us, right? So we'll spend a little time talking about that together this evening. I was doing some reading about depression at Christmas, not a very uplifting topic to read about, but a helpful one. And I ran across a website, just a counseling website, not a Christian website necessarily, but a website that provides support for cancer patients. And I read some interesting things I'd like to share with you now. It reads this way on the website: holly jolly parties, eggnog, gingerbread cookies, carols, and family celebrations. All signs of the holiday season. A time of giving and joy, the happiest time of the year, but not for everyone. For some, what should be a time of jubilation is a time of cold, dark despair. Forget about fa-la-la and donning gay apparel. You'd rather hide from Christmas on the couch in sweats and watch Seinfeld reruns. You've got the holiday blues. You're far from alone. If you've had a recent diagnosis of cancer or if your treatment isn't going well, you feel like you're on the island of misfit toys. On top of that, you feel bad for feeling bad. Others seem more vital than you. While they're hustling and bustling, you're exhausted. Christmas planning adds to your stress and sadness. You're sick of feeling like Scrooge. And it's interesting, website goes down along to list some of the triggers of the holiday blues, some creative headers for those triggers. First, your cousin Eddie, that was one of the headlines. It's not just the Griswold family, we all have one or more family members who drive us crazy and trigger bad memories. Second, over the river and through the woods, for people who love their family but are far away, the holidays can be heartbreaking. Being lonely can make people isolate themselves, which just continues on that vicious circle of depression. Third, grinchy life circumstances. You're not an ugly green monster who lives alone on a frigid mountaintop, but your circumstances make you feel like you are. And then finally, ho, 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 health problems. It's hard to feel the Christmas spirit when you don't feel well physically. Pretty good list there, if you think about it. And I wonder this evening, what's your trigger, right? What brings the holiday blues for you? What's on your mind this evening? What's in your heart this evening as Christmas fast approaches? If you'll turn with me to Matthew 1, that's going to be our text for this evening. The narrative of the birth of Jesus Christ. We're going to look at verses 18 through 25. And one of the precious promises related to the birth of Jesus Christ is, you are never alone. I hope you believe that. I hope you know that this evening. You are never, ever alone. So if you look with me, Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. Now the birth of Jesus Christ took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. And her husband Joseph, being a just man and unwilling to put her to shame, resolved to divorce her quietly. But as he considered these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not fear to take Mary as your wife, for that which is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son. You shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took his wife, but knew her not until she had given birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. I want to take a very practical look tonight at the name Emmanuel, which means God with us. I hope it's encouraging to you. Hope it's a de-stressor in some ways. I hope it's a help to you. But those three words, God with us, they're going to guide our journey this evening, really form our outline for our study tonight. And if you think about it, we've been talking about the cradle, cross, and crown. Really, these three words also sum up the message of Christmas, God with us. So first, the word God reveals Christ's power. God with us, God, Christ's power. Going back just a couple of Sundays, we took an in-depth look at the doctrine of the virgin birth. Some of you may not have been here. Most of you probably were, but I want to go back over that. I know it's review, but it's important. It's foundational for some of the practical things for the application for this evening. I want to review a few of those truths about the virgin birth. We dissected the text in Galatians 4, verses 4 and 5, and discovered the birth of Jesus stands alone. Birth of Jesus stands alone in history. So that verse 4 there, but when the fullness of time had come, Galatians 4, verse 4, God had been providentially working in the world, right, to set the stage for the entrance of Messiah, of the Savior, for his birth, for him to enter onto the scene. It was the perfect moment in history. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his son. You might remember the teaching on that. The Greek there, sent forth, really strongly suggests ascending out from the Father from a pre-existent state. Okay, Jesus existed before he was born in Bethlehem. Jesus existed before he was wrapped in swaddling clothes and laid in a manger. John 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, that's Jesus Christ, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we have seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. And a couple weeks ago we said the Son of God, Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity, was already the Son of God before he stepped into actually his creation. Not just creation, but his own creation. This world that he had made. The baby in the manger is the omnipotent creator of the universe. Very important for us to remember, because we all have needs tonight. He is able to provide for our needs. We'll get to that a little later. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son from that pre-existent state, born of woman. According to the Gospel of Matthew, the text we just read, the virgin birth was fulfillment of a prophecy. That would be the prophecy of Isaiah. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. Now, Matthew goes to great lengths to prove that Mary was a virgin. I don't know if you caught that as we read down through those verses 18 through 25, but all kinds of details that were obviously under inspiration of the Holy Spirit provided for us so we can be assured of the truth of the virgin birth. Verse 18, before they came together, right? That is Mary and Joseph. Before there was any union there, sexual union, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Verse 20, that which is conceived in her is from where? From the Holy Spirit. Verse 23, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. Verse 25, in case all of those details weren't enough, verse 25, Matthew writes, Joseph knew her not until she had given birth to a son. Right? So Jesus supernaturally conceived in the womb of Mary by the power of the Holy Spirit, the doctrine of the virgin birth. Absolutely necessary to secure a couple of things. To secure a nature that was fully human, secure a nature that was fully divine at the same time. Jesus, fully God, fully man. I came at this from a little different angle a couple Sundays ago. I want to share this story with you from World War II, from Billy Graham, highlights the significance of the incarnation. While fathers were away at war during World War II, mothers did all they could do to keep the fathers in the minds and the memories of their children. There was one particular mother who took her son into a bedroom every day, and she would show him a large portrait of his father. Well, one day the little boy said, Mother, wouldn't it be great if father could just step out of the frame? Right? That story from World War II highlights exactly what, or in many ways, a picture of what the incarnation was like, a picture of the very first Christmas in Bethlehem. Jesus, the image of the invisible God, Colossians 1. Jesus, Hebrews chapter 1, is the radiance of God's glory, the exact imprint of his nature. Jesus, fully God, fully man. You want to know what God looks like? Take a good look at Jesus, God the Son. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son, born of a woman, born under the law to redeem those under the law. We said this too, the virgin birth guarded Jesus against original sin. All of us have inherited that sin nature handed down to us from Adam, who acted as the representative head of mankind when he sinned there in the garden. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So that was handed down to everyone in this world except for Jesus. The virgin birth guarded him from a sin nature, which also enabled Jesus to go on to fulfill, to meet all of the law's requirements. Jesus did what no other man, a woman, child, anyone has ever been able to do, and that is to live an absolutely perfect life, to fulfill the law down to the very letter. Jesus, born under the law, fulfilled it in every way. And the sinless Son of God there sent forth from the Father to do what? To redeem us, to set us free, to set us free specifically by paying a price. That's what redemption means. We are all enslaved to sin from birth. Sin is our master. We can't buy our freedom in any way. Like Jesus, we're born under the law. Unlike Jesus, we can't keep its requirements. We all fall short. Jesus measures up. And he went on and absorbed the curse of the law. That is death. He absorbed that at the cross. He redeemed us. Purchased our freedom at what cost? The cost of his own precious blood shed for us on the cross. He did that. He rose again so death might be swallowed up in victory. And I know that's all summary, but again, it's important. We wrapped all the things up and we said, because of this, because you were bought with a price, you are to glorify the Lord Jesus Christ with your body, not just your body, but with your entire being, your whole life. Okay, so Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. The word God reveals Christ's power. Okay, the second word there, with, reveals Christ's presence. One pastor shared the details of what he dubbed one of the best days of his life. He may have been exaggerating a little bit, but he really enjoyed this particular day. I'll share his story. He writes, years ago, I was at a conference in Southern California. Had a free day, so I hopped on a boat to Catalina Island, about 25 miles off the coast. There's something about the ocean waves that recalibrates my spirit. I love the sun. There was plenty of it that day. I love books, and I had a good one. I love exploring new places, and I took a tour of Catalina Island and found it fascinating. There are actually buffalo that roam the island. I guess they took them there in the 1930s for filming a movie, and they've reproduced there since. I chilled on the beach, he writes. I did a little window shopping. I went parasailing. It was pretty close to my definition of a perfect day, except for one thing. You probably know where he's going. One thing was missing. All day I had this recurring thought, I wish my wife, Laura, was here with me. He writes, one of my dreams is to take her back so we can experience it together, right? The greatest experiences, he goes on to write, are shared experiences. And that is why the Almighty One became Emmanuel. That is why he is God most high and God most what? Nigh. You've probably heard that said before. God most near to us. So Jesus entered the world as a helpless baby, had to be changed, had to be clothed, had to be fed. At the incarnation, when the Word took on flesh, the transcendent became immanent, the infinite became finite, the eternal became mortal. Love how Charles Swindoll put it. When Jesus was cut, he bled. When Jesus was sad, he wept. When he was hungry, his stomach gnawed within. When he was cold, he shivered. When he was hot, he sweated. When his heart stopped, he died. Right? So Jesus, at the incarnation, willingly chose to identify with us, to identify with what it's like to walk in this world, what it's like to be human in every way. Hebrews 4:15, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, don't miss that last phrase, yet without sin. Obviously, a perfect, sinless humanity. Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. Another critical teaching about the incarnation is found in Philippians chapter 2, verses 6 through 8, which says this, Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Emptied himself. We talked about this a little while ago too. What that means is not an emptying of his divinity, of his deity, of his godness. No, he didn't empty himself by subtraction of deity. He emptied himself by addition of humanity. He was fully God And as such, Jesus had all the full rights of deity. But he set him aside. Set him aside, of course, for a season, so that he might identify with the people that he created. He set aside his right to display his full glory. Set aside his right to display or to exercise his independent authority. Submitted himself to the will of the Father during that season. He set aside the right to enjoy all the riches of heaven. As one person put it, God put on skin. It's so true. God put on skin, was born in the likeness of men. He became touchable and approachable. He emptied himself so that we might be full. And I mentioned John 15 on Sunday, this past Sunday. John 15, "These things have I spoken to you," Jesus said, "that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be full." Jesus gives us not just a joy, but his own joy poured out in our hearts. He emptied himself so we might be full. And we said he has removed the greatest obstacle to our joy, which is our sin. It's right here in Matthew chapter 1:2. "You shall call his name Jesus." Why? Because he will save his people from their sins. Sins have been put out of the way, that great obstacle, so that we can have his joy, so that our joy might be full. The greatest experiences are shared experiences. Jesus wants to share Christmas with you. I hope you believe that too this evening. He wants to share Christmas with you. He is closer than you could ever imagine. I love how A.W. Tozer put it. He says, "Trying to be happy without a sense of God's presence is like trying to have a bright day without the sun." That's so true. The greatest gift God gives us is the present of his presence, our title for this evening, which leads us to our final thought this evening. New material, I promise, new material. All the other stuff, foundational, very important for applying the truth. The word "us," God with us, the word "us" reveals Christ's purpose. You know, I think sometimes we have all the knowledge. I, as your pastor, I have the knowledge, but sometimes I lack the application, the follow-through of that knowledge in my life, application of the truth. So Jesus is very much with us. Don't miss this. Jesus is very much for us, right? Romans 8, if God is for us, then who can be against us? I love the couple of Christmas carols, the lyrics there. "Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee," right? "Joy to the world, the Lord is come." And I know I keep going back to this one, but every time I talk about the omnipresence of God, I got to go back to the way A.W. Tozer describes it, because it is just so good. He says this: "Christ is everywhere here, close to you, next to you." And you can't say it any better than that. Christ everywhere here, close to us, next to us. So I ask you again, what's triggering the holiday blues this evening? Something on your mind this evening. I know there's something on your heart. Is it unrealistic expectations? Overwhelming responsibilities? I've been honestly feeling a little bit of that. And I kind of was burdened by that yesterday, and then I jumped back into studying for tonight, and the Lord kind of lifted that weight off my shoulders again. Is it social interactions? Not Cousin Eddie, but maybe some other family member. The challenges of gathering together. I shared an article with you some time ago, but again, very fitting for this evening. If you're dealing with those unrealistic expectations, the stress of all the preparations, of pulling everything together, whether it's buying the gifts or preparing the meal or inviting the family in, this story's for you. Written by a woman who confesses that shopping, hosting parties, cooking meals tends to bring out the Martha in her. You might remember the story now. She was at a candlelit service, and in her own words, "Listening to the peaceful strains of silent night, I wrestled in my mind with a list of things to be done. That might be you even tonight, wrestling with that list. My lips moved to the words while my brain mulled over various menus for our annual Christmas Eve buffet. Realizing this, I felt a stab of guilt, bowed my head. Father, let me see Christmas through your eyes tonight. Wonder and immense gratitude settled upon me. Into my heart, God whispered, if there was ever a time to worship me, it's now. The season is about me only, but each year you crowd me out with the inconsequential. She finishes that article with these words. Delicious dinners are nice. Perfect gifts are delightful. But I'm learning that only one thing really matters. While I tend to be more like Martha, at Christmas, 'tis the season to be what? To be Mary, M-A-R-Y. I think we're all familiar with that story this evening, most of us. Mary and Martha, very close friends of Jesus. Jesus had been traveling, rigorous ministry schedule. He's tired, he's hungry, needs a place to rest. Mary, Martha, Lazarus, they invite him and the disciples into their home. Martha springs into action, making all the preparations. So much to do, so little time to do it. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? Just a few days before Christmas. Mary's inclination, though, sit at the feet of Jesus and worship. Much to learn and no time to waste for Mary. Martha distracted, Mary focused. Martha's eyes fixed on preparations, Mary's eyes fixed on Jesus. Martha's intentions, good, right? She wanted everything to be perfect for her guests. That's a good thing. But Mary was in the right place at the feet of Jesus in true worship, eyes fixed on him, ears open to his instruction, heart ready to obey. And as we think about this lady's story, as we think about Mary and Martha, this Christmas we do well to be still and to know that he is God, to stop for a moment and to listen for his voice. Not an audible voice necessarily, but his voice as spoken through his perfect word. Let's listen to him. Let's be still and know that he is God. The greatest gift Jesus gives is the present of his presence. It's wrapped in under the tree. It's interesting. It's kind of like the gift of salvation, right? It's got to be received. It's got to be opened. It's got to be treasured. He's offered it, right? He's everywhere here, close to you, next to you. The present is there, but we've got to take advantage of that. We've got to receive it as our own. Jesus, very much with you, very much for you. Maybe it's the burden of preparations, maybe it's not. Maybe it's finances. Things are a little rough. I think we're all feeling that this Christmas season. Maybe it's finances, maybe it's fatigue, maybe it's travel, you're stressing out about that. Maybe it's loneliness, sickness, maybe it's grief, maybe it's estrangement with a family member. Whatever it is, I'll say it again, Jesus everywhere here, close to you, next to you. Jesus very much with you, Jesus very much for you this evening. Charles Spurgeon had a way with words. Listen to what he said about the truth of Emmanuel, God with us. This is great. And an extemporary preacher too, extemporaneously would just put these things out there. It boggles my mind. But here's what he said. He said, it is hell's terror. This is Emmanuel, God with us. Satan trembles at the sound of it. Let him come to you suddenly. And do you but whisper that word, God with us, back he falls, confounded and confused. God with us is the laborer's strength. How could he preach the gospel? How could he bend his knees in prayer? How could the missionary go into the foreign lands? How could the martyr stand at the stake? How could men labor if that one word were taken away? God with us is eternity's sonnet, heaven's hallelujah, the shout of the glorified, the song of the redeemed, the chorus of the angels, and the everlasting oratorio of the great orchestra in the sky. Man, he's got a way with words. That's beautiful and so true. Emmanuel, God with us. I quoted Hebrews 4:15 moments ago, "For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but one who is in every respect, who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin." But then the author continues, and you know this well, verse 16, "Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need." Right? As the Son of Man, Jesus knows your need this evening. He gets it. He understands you. He walked in your shoes, so to speak. He's experienced it all in this world and much more, much worse in some ways. He cares deeply. As the Son of God, He's able to provide for your need, right? He is the omnipotent one. He's the creator of the universe. He's able to do all things. And He invites you to that throne of grace where you can find help in your time of need. If you draw near to God, the scriptures say He will draw near to you. So I want to bolster your faith this evening. I can't do like Charles Spurgeon does, so I'm going to lay the word of God on you instead, okay? I want to bolster your faith this evening in the presence of God, the presence of the Lord Jesus with you this Christmas. Psalm 139, 7 through 12. "Where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you." Psalm 139. Isaiah 41:10. "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." And Matthew 28, here's for those interactions, some of those social interactions this Christmas, 19 and 20. "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." In John 14, Jesus' promise after His departure, verses 16 through 18, "And I will ask the Father, He will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees Him nor knows Him. You know Him, and He dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you." What a beautiful passage of Scripture. Then Revelation chapter 21, verse 3, talking about heaven, the Apostle John, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be His people, and God Himself will be with them as their God." Right? Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, God with us today, tomorrow, and forevermore. Father, thank You for this time again this evening in the Grow class, in Your word together, the sweet fellowship we enjoy. And we thank You for the sweet fellowship we enjoy, not just with each other, but with You. What beautiful truth, the story of Christmas, that Father, You would send Your one and only Son as that precious gift so we might know You, we might know what You're like, that You might be with us and might understand us. And we thank You for that. Thank You for Christmas. Thank You for Your presence with us, even in difficult times. And I know there are heavy burdens on hearts this evening here in the auditorium, those listening online as well. Some homebound, some struggling with cancer, some with sickness, some just stressed out about all there is to do. I pray that You would comfort them with the knowledge of Your presence. Comfort them with the promises of Your word this evening. We thank You that Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us now and forever. And I pray that we would honor You as we go out from here. that we would be a light for you, as was prayed earlier. And as this Christmas Eve service comes up on Sunday, that we would be out and inviting those who don't know you, who've never experienced the light, that they might come and hear the truth and experience what life is like with you and know eternal life, know your presence. I pray all this in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Thank you all for coming out this evening. Be careful on your way home. Enjoy some fellowship there out in the lobby this evening.